I perceived how I detached myself from my body. My body was down there when I went out and I was above it. First, I had a sense of movement, a sense that I had moved. Then it became more like floating. And after a while, it became kind of like being magnetically attracted to the light.
Sie sind Psychotherapeutin in Zürich.
Ms. Züllig, you are a psychotherapist in Zurich, and one of your specialities is working on near-death experiences. Your interest in that topic isn't random. You personally have had a near-death experience at the age of 16. What exactly had happened?
Ich war krank. Ich hatte schwere Asthmaanfälle.
I was ill. I used to have severe asthma attacks. It was a rather difficult crisis during my youth, and I was hospitalized after a severe asthma attack. I was living in Milan at that time. They gave me some medication, and it was a collapse, a total breakdown of my system. It's called an allergic shock or an anaphylactic shock. I don't have any memories about that. I only remember what happened before that, and I remember what was happening when I woke up.
What exactly did you experience at the threshold of death? Was it that you can recall?
I perceived how I detached myself from my body. My body was down there when I went out and I was above it. First, I had a sense of movement, a sense that I had moved. Then it became more like floating. And after a while, it became kind of like being magnetically attracted to the light. I painted this picture that shows the light that I felt pulled towards and attracted to. It was like I was a piece or a chunk of light, and out there was the huge light, and I was being pulled inside of that light. And then I felt like I was dissolved. I didn't exist anymore. I was just that light. And that was wonderful. It was the most amazing feeling that I have ever had. You could hardly experience that in a physical body. I don't think it's possible, even though people try from time to time to get there, but that is probably only possible if you're moving without a body. I didn't have a choice. I didn't have communication. No verbal communication. But I have realized pretty quickly that I can't stay there. And I felt that I was being pulled back inside my body. Coming back was the complete opposite of leaving. Leaving was extremely enjoyable and beautiful, and you want to stay there forever. If I had a choice, I wouldn't have come back. Being squeezed back inside my body was very painful. Because I was very wide and big, and my body was so small, it was like trying to put on a wet dress that is way too small, and you can't really get inside.
What exactly was it like for you after that near-death experience? A few decades ago, there was no term like near-death experiences. Were you able to talk about it with other people?
No. Not at all. I didn't even have the words to describe it. And I don't really remember that exactly, but whenever I made attempts to describe what I had experienced, I didn't get across to anyone and I stopped trying. I have put it away, like putting something in the freezer. I couldn't deal with it at all. For 17 years, I haven't known that I had had a near-death experience. I didn't even know that near-death experiences existed. I just knew that there is something within me, and I want to find out what it's all about.
And then you took your experience back out of the freezer?
Yes. 17 years later. I have finished studying psychology because I wanted to know what's going on with me. Of course, I thought something was wrong. I am not normal. I am not like others. But I couldn't solve it in a positive way. I couldn't grasp it. It was impossible. And then, psychopathology didn't give me any answers, or rather unsatisfying answers, so I had to keep searching. And then I went to California, and I was able to finish my PhD there, which was a huge blessing. And that's where I met Ken Ring. I have read Raymond Moody's book, I attended his lectures, but the connection wasn't there, it didn't click with me. But with Ken Ring, it clicked immediately. And then I knew what's going on with me.
Do you have the impression that this experience has been an influence on your whole life until now?
Definitely. For sure.
In which way?
The work I do. And I have been studying and learning for decades to be able to do that work. I also specialize in trauma therapy and near-death experiences. And to recognize immediately when people come to me, how they express themselves, which words they choose, what they say and what they don't say, and what they can't say, it changes one's overall perception. It changes one's metabolism. There are some profound changes that are caused by a near-death experience. And I have also suffered from these changes. For instance, when I have realized that I perceive things which other people don't perceive. How do I deal with perceptions that I'm not supposed to express? This is a huge learning process.
How would you classify your own near-death experience in retrospect? As a hint of eternal life or as an extended consciousness of the mind?
Well, after death, that's a little bit difficult. I think it's a level of consciousness that's always there, where we can reach up with our antenna or not. But whether it's before or after, in this dimension, time does not exist. Of course, it's easier to enter these dimensions if you're not distracted anymore by the material level.
You're also a member of the board of Swiss IANS. That's a society that is dedicated to research on near-death experiences. You're also informed about international studies in this field. What are, in your eyes, the most important results of the studies of near-death experiences, all in all, over the last decades, in this field of thanatology?
There are things we can't measure. Especially addressing physicians, I have a wish. I would like to say that there are so many more things we can't measure in no way or form.
In regards to the situation, not only in Europe but in the whole world, what are the most important goals of thanatology, internationally speaking?
It's all about awareness. And in America, they are very much ahead of us here in Europe in that sense. There is a lot going on there. I have built a chapter on near-death experiences in Vancouver, and within a short amount of time, about 30 people were joining. And that's no big deal there. There's a lot more awareness at the West Coast. They are further ahead. And it takes time until it arrives in Switzerland. Switzerland was one of the last countries in that respect. Germany was a lot earlier, France was earlier, and it's not that easy to bring that here. And it's all about awareness. Awareness that we are more than we assume to be. And that we can be more confident about it. It's also about a more humane picture of mankind. That we can deal with each other in a different way, especially in a time when so many conflicts are erupting. It's so important that we start to find solutions all together instead of being against each other.
What exactly happens at the end of our lives is such an interesting topic. Why is that, that death is still such a taboo subject? Is that because of the fear of death?
Yes, I would say it's fear. Death is the strongest transition or change that exists. And if we deal with it, then we are also ready to change ourselves. But if we are doing great, and here in Switzerland we're doing very well in a material way, then there is no big interest in changing ourselves.
Could you tell us a little bit about your work as a therapist? What different approaches are there to help people with trauma or near-death experiences?
Well, there are two levels. One of them are the different levels of consciousness. In my dissertation, I have compiled something. On the one hand, there is psychology, and on the other hand, there is spirituality and how they come together. It is a little hard to explain, but we develop ourselves through different levels of consciousness, comparable to the different chakras. These are energy centers, subtle energy centers, and at the same time, there are also levels of consciousness. It's possible to describe very accurately what's going on these different levels of consciousness. And that surpasses the concepts that we have found in development psychology, because it goes far beyond that, into the spiritual levels of consciousness. Dr. Elisabeth Kübler-Ross has worked in this field, and she has diversified the grieving process into four phases or levels. And in my concepts, there is everything diversified into seven different phases or levels. It's about the grieving process and the awareness of death and the fact that we are going to die, at least the body will die. That is the one level. And the other level is when people come to me, they are often in contractions, they are in pain, life hurts them. Maybe they have strong physical symptoms or psychological states that annoy them very much. It's comparable to a birth. People come here when they are feeling very bad. They might even have suicidal thoughts. And then my focus is on doing the totally classical trauma work with them. And at the same time, explaining to them what process is going on with them, that helps to find orientation. They know it goes down, it can even go a little further down, but then it goes back up again. Most of the time, they don't need details when they come here. But just knowing that it might go a little bit further down, but that it will go up again, gives them a reference point and some orientation. And then we can look into the cause that triggered this crisis. But always with that knowledge in mind, that it's actually a level of consciousness and they are about to grow into the next level. I actually think of myself as an obstetrician, as a midwife, for the spiritual part of human beings.
What are your goals concerning public relations in the near future?
To find space where we can gather and present ourselves, to go out and reach as many people as possible, especially people in the medical field, physicians, doctors, registered nurses, all kind of medical staff, people who are the first ones to be near patients who have, for example, just come out of a coma and have to tell something. Because if someone wants to tell about what he had experienced, and the medical staff shake their heads and they say that the patient needs sedatives to calm down, then it has happened again. It is very important to inform people in the medical field that they should be open to such reports, even if they don't believe in anything like that personally. At least so they know that there is a place where they can refer those patients to, where they are accepted and appreciated and protected. Just to bring out awareness to the public, with radio programs, for instance, there are different things that we can activate already. But it takes time. We must be prepared if people come to us. There must be enough people to welcome them and to do therapy work and build up support groups. I have just formed a group of 10 people. We have meetings and we talk about near-death experiences. It's in the beginning stages here in Zurich, and I hope that we will grow.
Many people are very much afraid of death and dying. If you had to name just one approach to minimize that fear, which would that be?
To help people to ground themselves. Most of the time, fear comes from floating around. And this would be an approach from somatic experiencing of trauma therapy, to advise people to find ways to ground themselves, to come down to earth, to really feel the ground beneath their feet again, to consciously feel themselves inside of their bodies again, because that's when the fear is gone most of the time. That's how we work with people who suffer from severe phobias. The most important thing is to help them to start to feel themselves again, on a sensual level, to recognize what is really here. Most of the time, it's an illusion. Death in and of itself is such a wonderful experience. What's coming with it, in terms of the actual reason for it, well, that's something not even I am sure of. I don't know if I may be in the hospital and what they will actually do with me. That's maybe something that I am afraid of. If of anything, then about that. But death itself is actually really a liberation.
What exactly is the influence of someone's worldview on their approach to death? Is it easier for people with a religious background? Are there any categories at all? Can you say that people who think this or that will be more easygoing with dying?
It's hard for me to categorize people. But if people's needs, for example, when they were small children, were met all the time, when they were hungry or thirsty or afraid, then they have internalized this attitude that there is someone who cares for them. And then the access to the divine may be a lot easier for these people. But if there had been some kind of vacuum, people have a very hard time to imagine that there could be something that could liberate them from their misery. And that can also happen to people who are religious. Religion can, under certain circumstances, help to build a connection, but that is not necessarily so. There are many people who are very connected without being religious. For instance, I wouldn't call myself religious, but rather spiritual. Exploring the spiritual levels, I do think that's very important. That makes it a lot easier. As the Buddhist monks say, if you learn to die, you learn to live. They dedicate their lives to learn how to die. And in extreme situations, these people run into burning houses to rescue others because they have absolutely no fear, because they have learned that there is so much more than just the physical body.
If people report on their own near-death experiences, they mostly tell us about positive experiences, out-of-body experiences, encounters with the light, feelings of well-being and protection. But one of the most difficult aspects of that experience is that they have to return into their bodies. Are there any possibilities for therapy work to help people to return with ease?
Yes, it would be quite helpful to know more about the topic trauma. That's a diagnosis that has been accepted in the last decade in psychiatry and medicine. That is a very important aspect. A near-death experience is a severe trauma. It is a severe shock. And how does a person deal with that? The main problem is communication. To find the words to communicate with those who weren't there yet. And it's a good question how we could help in such situations. That's why it is so important to train professionals in dealing with trauma and near-death experiences, so that both aspects are being taken seriously. Then a lot more people would dare to speak up and tell us about their near-death experiences. Because not everyone has experienced enlightenment. How can people come back and start to communicate without experiencing violence, without false diagnosis, without judgments? That's very bad for people who have had near-death experiences. And therefore, many people are so afraid of telling anything about it, afraid of being criticized or being diagnosed as mentally ill or being categorized as a mad person. So it's all about broadening the awareness of everyone. If things are not the way they should normally be, that people do not immediately judge. And the solution is non-violent communication. Marshall B. Rosenberg has made such a tremendous contribution to society and a way for us to learn nonviolent communication. That is something not only for near-death experiences, but for all of us in general, especially for people who were traumatized and simply communicate differently. For instance, the refugees that have arrived here are traumatized people. Some are severely traumatized. They might have been in life-threatening situations for a long period of time. They might have experienced things we can hardly imagine. How do we deal with such people? How do we interact with them without judging? It's all about humanity again.
Are there some rules that are universally valid concerning dealing with trauma?
That is a little bit difficult because everyone is traumatized differently, and every trauma falls on different grounds. For instance, if someone experiences a trauma, let's say a car accident, and that person has had a good life with a good childhood and solid grounds beneath his feet, then this trauma will not have such severe consequences. But for someone who has maybe had his first traumatic experience during his birth and several additional traumatic experiences when growing up in the way he was raised, then that's a whole other story. So there are a lot of differences. It's hard to speak generally. The whole field of psychotraumatology is relatively new. But trauma can only be solved by working on the body. Just talking to someone is not enough in most cases of severe trauma. They are placed in cellular storage, and we must dissolve those pictures that are sometimes stored on a cellular level. That's an act of liberating those pictures and leaving them behind. And then it's very important to teach those people to come back into physical body, to start to feel well again in their own body, to be able to release those traumatic experiences out of the body with the help of trauma therapy. What could be said generally speaking? It's very important to come from the heart and to see that essentially we are all the same and we have the same rights. This would be my message.
Ms. Züllig, I wish you all the best for your professional life as well as for your increasing awareness of your network for people who have had near-death experiences. And thank you so much for this interview.